Our guest today is Steve Davis. He is an author of Undercurrents, a senior strategic advisor and interim director of Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, a distinguished fellow at the World Economic Forum, and he's also a Stanford lecturer. Steve, welcome to our podcast.
Thanks for having me today. It's my pleasure.
So this is our second go to it because our first time we had a little bit of technical difficulties. But what most inspired me is that everyone seems like they want to make a difference. And you literally, when you're at this World Economic Forum, for our listeners who don't know, it's literally the premier platform, network, community of world leaders and heads of states that are making the change. And you work with Bill and Melinda Gates. So tell us the backstory of all this. How did you decide to perhaps make this difference at this scale?
Well, I don't think I ever woke up and said, I'm going to do this, the kind of work I'm doing. And my journey has been one of a lot of jigs and jags from working. I grew up in Montana in a small ranching community and ended up, leaving and heading in. It was a human rights activist at one point, did a lot of work in technology and the internet at one point. But I've always kept very engaged on social issues, social change. I had a lot of inspiring reasons as a kid, I think, to learn a lot about how our community worked. And my father and uncles and aunts were quite involved in politics. So love to kind of get into like, how do you actually change the world? And I've ended up spending a lot of my life working on those issues.
Yeah. And you shared a story about your aunt and how she impacted you. Can you share that story with our guests?
Sure. I think the question that you had asked me is, you know, what was there a moment in your childhood that, you know, was a good a representation of this sort of curiosity that has propelled me to do a lot of different things, everything from, you know, work in China to jump into the internet before anybody knew what it was. And I remember a moment I was on a big lake in Montana where we had spent time and I had a very lovely and interesting aunt who always encouraged us to think bigger and think beyond the boundaries of Montana. And I remember it was the day that the men landed on the moon for the first time. And we were down at the lake and she literally unraveled a cord and a cable to bring the television down. So we could not miss the man on the moon because we didn't want to get out of the lake. And to me, it was like, you know, making sure that curiosity and that idea that we can achieve great things wasn't lost on us as kids.
Interesting. I'm really always fascinated by people's surroundings, whether you growing up in Montana, but also you being at Stanford. So I was watching an interview with Steve Jobs, and he talked about how Stanford, which a lot of people may or may not know, it's essentially this great fertile soil of great minds. Even if Elon Musk went there and dropped out, or Sergey Brin and Larry Page went there as well, or even the founder of Victoria's Secret went there. So what do you most love about Stanford, and what do you hope, because not everyone's going to have the ability to work there as you and teach there, but what do you teach your students that we can learn from you about how to make a difference in the world?
Yeah, well, no, Stanford's a great place. There are a lot of great universities, both public and private around the world. And Stanford's one of them where there's a real culture of innovation, and it has, you know, by virtue of its history and frankly, its pocketbook has been able to attract a lot of really top people. And of course, the location that its main campus is in Silicon Valley is not insignificant. But, you know, look, my goal at Stanford has been to come in and to help support the kind of innovation curriculum, and particularly in social innovation that would have social impact. And there is in that culture, both at Stanford and other big universities, there's a lot of focus on first stage innovation, startups, new ideas, and they're amazing. And that's really important and a great thing for universities to do. And that's what wins Nobel Prizes and wins MacArthur Genius Awards, which there are a lot of around there. But there are also, you know, there's an increasing focus on Well, what does this look like at the in the community? So there's now more and more programs for students to go and volunteer in East Palo Alto or East Harlem or Kinshasa or somewhere around the world. And those are great too, because they get more exposure to what, you know, where the rubber meets the road. But I come in with a, like the journey between the garage, those great ideas, and that last mile, whether it's in the US or in Africa, is a huge and complicated journey of, you know, taking an idea, whether it's a product or a service, figuring out how to adapt it, get it approved, build it, build partnerships, figure out how you start creating demand, you know, ensuring you're getting all the endorsements, all that stuff. So I actually focus on how to scale up social innovation. And so how do we take great ideas for which that place is full of, but a lot of them actually never see the light of day or don't see it at scale. And how do we help support those innovators to get to scale?
And how do you feel you learned that to understand how to scale different companies and whatnot?
Yeah, well, I kind of joke, and actually I just wrote a book called Undercurrents, and it's about some of the trends in social activism and innovation, and it's about, the subtitle is Sparking, Channeling Outrage to Spark Practical Activism. And I would say my thesis is that it does take a lot of practical activism. It's activism in its best sense of getting things done, being slightly disruptive sometimes, but it's not the scary type of, you know, corporate activism or street activism always that people think about, but it's like doing those small but and sometimes pretty unsexy things. So and so one of the big themes in my teaching, as well as a chapter in the book, is about navigating this unsexy middle, which is the, you know, learning about, you know, kind of the slog of day-to-day work on whether you're an accountant that you can then contribute by helping people figure out the finances, or you're working on getting something approved by a regulator, et cetera. So I think, you know, a lot of this is about scaling up great ideas and can take a lot of people's talent and time who may think of themselves not as activists, but think of themselves, hey, I'm just an accountant. And yet they can contribute in great ways. And I hope this will encourage them to do that.
That's great. Two last questions, Steve. One is, I love learning from great leaders. It's one thing to read a book or to watch an interview, but you have worked with Bill and Melinda Gates. If let's say Steve Jobs is known for his amazing, simple design, or Jeff Bezos loves about talking about customer obsession, what do you feel you learn most from Bill Gates?
Yeah, no, I've been very lucky. Bill and I have been friends for a number of years. We've worked together on a whole lot of different things. We built a company together. I'm you know, now overseeing their China program at the foundation just for a while. But so look, Bill's a very super talented and committed guy. And I guess the two things I would say that, you know, I hope I can, you know, learn some from him. He's the master. But one is just, you know, really being a good listener and listening and assuming that, I mean, people, you know, he's certainly not short of ego, but he really does believe that he can learn from a lot of others all the time. And so he's just a brilliant synthesizer of information because he's learning and listening to others. So that's a great lesson. And then the other, you know, I would say is, you know, he spends a lot of time, let's focus on where the log jams are. So we tend to spend time, like, let's drill down into this problem area and see if we can solve it, rather than spending most of our time celebrating successes, which we have had plenty of. And I think that just keeps me and people around him pushing harder for better answers.
That's awesome. Last question, Steve. Activism, again, not everyone might think of themselves as an activist, but what can we all do each day to have that activism in ourselves? What's a daily action we can all do each day?
Yeah, I would say the thesis of my book, and I would argue is a good daily practice, is to not be defeated by the headlines. The focus of the book is to say, despite a lot of headlines, which can be quite negative or discouraging, the world is actually getting better. The trend lines are actually quite impressive if you look at global trends in terms of mortality rates going down, girls getting educated, more agricultural productivity. There's just a lot of positive trends. So start every day, with a view that it's not, to almost put down the paper and remember that there is opportunity and for a lot of to keep those trends going the right direction. And therefore, have some optimism. And with that optimism, you can find a practical way to, in whether it's your job or in your neighborhood or in your family, or there's some national or global issue that you want to engage in and find your small contribution, but with the idea that it's going in the right direction.
Awesome. Steve, thank you again for sharing your thoughts with our guests. Have a great day.
Thank you very much. Take care.